He stays always near.
Said he lives in my heart. And he hears when I cry. I call on his name till the storm passes by.
So why should I worry? Why should I fear? When the very same Jesus, he stays always near.
Said he lives in my heart.
This is the best part of the service. Please help us welcome Sister Rose as she comes.
Well, it's good to be here. The Lord is so good, so wonderful. I thank him this morning, and I hope you do too. You didn't just have to be here. But God has been so good to all of us, giving us a chance and an opportunity to live for him and one day leave this world and be with him forever throughout eternity. So we're glad that you're here today. We hope that you came with an open mind to receive whatever the Lord wants to give to you. And he always got something for everybody. And I know that without a doubt. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Philippians, the 4th chapter. Father, we're grateful this morning for your blessings. Thank you for being so good to us. Thank you because nobody would ever love us enough to die for us. And we thank you, God, because you've never failed us, but you've always been there. I pray now, God, that your people would have an ear to hear and a heart to receive. I pray, God, that you would give me the anointing to deliver to your people. And we'll be careful to give you glory and praise and honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. The 4th chapter of Philippians says in the 10th verse, I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at the last your care of me hath flourished again, wherein ye were also careful, but ye lacked opportunity. Not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content. I know both how to be abased. I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things, I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. And I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. I want to preach to you a little while this morning. Do we not live in a discontented society? It's so true. I think most people know how to kind of go along when everything is going their way. But the Apostle Paul said, I learned how to be content no matter what state I was in. Every person in this building this morning should practice that. Things don't have to be going perfect for you to be happy. Things don't have to be exactly the way you want it just so that you can feel that, hey, I got it going on. But more or less, we need to look at the fact when things don't go good, what am I doing? Or am I sitting around crying and fretting myself and depressed and eating all the bonbons we can eat and everything else? What are we doing? Sometimes we resort to alcohol and to drugs and what have you because life changes on us. You know what? Live a little longer. You'll find out it's going to change some every day. Something you may have had yesterday, you may good, some bad. And Job, I think it was, he said, man better enjoy his days. You know why? The days that are happy, enjoy them because they will be few. But you know what? In spite of all those things, if we've got God in our life, there is no doubt that we can be happy in spite of everything. And it's going to take God to help you to get there. That's why we have so many depressed people and down and out and messed up and they don't know what to do, where to go, who's going to help me. Everything just turned upside down. It's the way life does. We have to understand we're limited to what we can do. So Paul said, when he's talking to the church, I'm not speaking to you in want, for I've learned whatsoever state I am to be content, to be happy. I know how to be abased. I know how to be low. I know how to abound everywhere in all things. I know how to live large in spite of. He says, I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. You know what? I don't think we're doing very well when we say, yeah, I can handle everything until I ain't got nothing to eat. Some people feel that way. One of the ladies in our church said to the Lord when she got saved, she said, Lord, just always keep me with some food on the table. I don't really have to have anything else, just something to eat. And that may be the sense of a lot of African-American families. You know why? Because when we couldn't do nothing else, we could eat. I mean, a lot of things were turned off to us, a lot of privilege and opportunity that most people have. We didn't get a chance to have it. So we sat down and we said, hey, let's eat out and have something good. I've seen people in the worst situation say, well, girl, let's get something to eat. It's almost like this is a fix it. You know, if we get something to eat, hey, it ain't going to be so bad. But you know what's not good, though? It's not good when you resort only to that. Because over the long run, it's gonna take advantage of you and put you in a situation where you shouldn't be. So if we go to the Caucasian race, they're going to be okay as long as they've got enough in savings, as long as they've got a 401k, so long as, you know, things are going good. Not long ago, I don't know if you heard it, but I did something. I don't know how long it's been now. And this man was a multi-billionaire, and the stock market crashed. Not completely crashed, but really lost a lot of money. This man, I think he had something like maybe $10 or $20 billion. And when he lost a billion, he killed himself. And I thought to myself, I could live pretty happy off of that. Are you kidding me? He lost $1 billion out of the billions he had, and he put a gun to his head and killed himself. I mean, the average black person don't even have to have a billion. You know, you're going to kill yourself over $1 billion? A lot of us will never see a billion, will never know what it's like, or any of those things. But you know what? Life is good. Even when you're going through the toughest times, life is good. You don't just have to sit around and feel bad about it. So, Paul said, I know how to do all these things. And how am I managing to do these things? Through Christ who strengthens me. He helps me. That's why I can go through it. So no matter what comes in my life, I can do all things through Christ. That gives me the strength to go through. That gives me the courage and all these things. And let me not give up on life, but keep going. And be a help to somebody else. I went to a salon one time to have my nails done, and this lady sitting over there by me, and I kept looking at this lady. I thought, what in the world could be her problem? The whole time she sat there, she was like this. I started to meddle, and I thought, well, no. I want to know what's wrong. Her phone rang, and she picked up her phone, and she still was like this. You know what? You better stop this. You're going to have a lot of wrinkles for your time. Most of us don't want that. But she sat there, frowned up the entire time. And have you ever noticed if you're feeling pretty good, if you go around somebody that's unhappy, you start feeling it? You, all of a sudden you think, well, why am I feeling bad? I felt pretty good this morning. Until you talk to somebody who's down in the dumps. And then when you try to help them to get up, they don't want to get up. And I tell you, this is happening. You don't understand. I'm trying to tell you, no matter what it is, get up. Don't let it bear down on you. Don't let it kill you. Yes. So then what we must learn how to do these things. It's not a part of human nature, but we can learn how to do it. Okay, I don't have to be sad because everything is sad. I don't have to be down because everything else around me is down. Why can't I stand up in the midst of all this and say, wait a minute, I'm going to give God the glory no matter what? Everybody that's anybody in this world that ever read their Bible, one book they know about is Job. Job could have been depressed every day. We're talking about a rich man who had more than most in his days, had a beautiful family of children, had a wife, had cattle, you name it, he had it. And he lost it all in a moment. But you know what? You know what he did? He went in and prayed and worshiped God and said, the Lord give it and the Lord take it away. So whatever's going on, God gave it. He can take it away. I'm going to look up and say, thank you anyway. And you know what? I could not have had it for the time I had it. I could have never been rich. I could have never had all that. So if we look at our lives, and you know what? I think this applies to everybody. Remember, no matter how bad your situation is, somebody's worse. Somebody's worse. While you're complaining about one thing or that thing or over here, somebody is a whole lot worse than you. Somebody just wish they could buy a loaf of bread. And you say, well, I want more than bread. Somebody's wishing for a loaf. Somebody, you said, I don't like those shoes. I went back and that didn't work. There's a man or woman that don't have feet to put those shoes on. So when you look at your life this morning while you're complaining, thank God I can see, I can hear, I can walk, I can talk. Yes, I can move around. I don't need anybody to assist me. My life is good for the most part. Is it perfect? It's not necessarily supposed to be perfect, but with God you can go through anything. You can really do it. I was looking this morning. Let me look at this for a minute. And it was talking about the effects of unhappiness. And it says people who are unhappy often complain about feeling tired all the time. They also tend to have trouble sleeping. Other symptoms include irritability, anger, loss of interest in things that used to bring pleasure, including sex. We don't know many people like that. And it may be described... may be described as a feeling of emptiness or hopelessness. Some people may find it difficult to put these feelings into words. Frequent episodes of crying may be a sign of unhappiness, but not everyone who is unhappy cries. So some people cry, some people don't. So it's hard to just tag them with one particular thing. If you do this, then that means you're unhappy. Not necessarily. Why have we become a society that we feel like we have to have everything like the next door neighbor or like John Doe or whoever, because if I just had what he had or she had, how much happier I would be? Not necessarily true. We tend to believe that life and happiness consists of all that we can possess of the goods of this world. We tend to believe that's happening, but it's not. How many people we've seen and heard in our lifetime who had all of that and still was very unhappy? But I think we still tell ourselves, but if I had it, it would be different for me. No, it would not. Because a man's life does not consist of the abundance of things that he has. It's more than that. It's what's happening inside of me. It's what I feel in my heart. Happiness has to begin in your heart. When we get a changed heart, we get happy. I know what it feels like to be sad. I know what it feels like to be depressed. I've been there. I know what it feels like to wish that things would just turn over, but they didn't. I know what it feels like to be pregnant and mad all the way through. Yes. You say if you're trying to get pregnant, there's a way to stop it. Yeah, it is. I used to go to my appointments when I was pregnant. I had 7 children, plus I had a set of twins that were totally, completely, absolutely unexpected. And when I went there, the ladies would be all sitting next to each other, and they'd be saying, "Hi, what is your baby do?" And they were just so excited. I just sat there and kept looking straight ahead. And after a while, somebody else said, "So, what does your baby do? Are you looking for a girl or a boy?" I didn't say nothing. Somebody said, "Hi, what's your name?" I said, "Rose." I thought, I don't feel like talking. Talk to these other people. And then she said, "So, are you excited?" I said, "No, honey, you don't get excited after this many babies. Are you kidding me? Excited about what? Another diaper to change? Another baby that keeps you up all night? You're not excited. People are excited they couldn't get a baby and had a hard time trying to get one and finally got one. That never was my problem." So somebody says, "Me and John, we're so happy we're pregnant. I never understand that we're pregnant because he's not pregnant. He played a minor role, but he's not having nothing." Like I used to tell my husband, I said, he come home one day and said, "Honey, I was out there talking to a guy on the post. He said, you don't look like you have 7 children." I said, "Did you tell him you don't? Did you tell him that? You should have. I had 7 children. Yes, and I thought about the guy, what's his name? I always get these stars mixed up because I don't watch enough of them. The one, that's, his last name is Cool. L Cool J? Cool J. Everybody loved his abs because they were so tight and so hard. And he said, somebody asked his wife one day about, do you work out with him? Well, she said, "No. He didn't have any babies. I did. My abs will never quite look like that. No." But you know what? You got to learn to make the best of life. If it's difficult, things not going just right, and you don't like it, some things we can change, some things we don't change. So the things that you can change, quit grumbling about it and do something about it and change it. And if you can't change it, accept the fact that God's going to have to help me go through this. I can't do it by myself. And he will help you. You don't have to go through all those changes and upset and what have you. And everything was going great. Parents oftentimes do this. You know what? I had such dreams for my kids and for John and for this one and for that one. And I just dreamed all these big dreams. Your kids, 9 times out of 10, will never want share in your dream. Because what you wanted and what you liked, your kids may never like it. I had to accept that about my kids. Yeah, I got to be sure that all of them get a good education. I got to be sure that they excel and go to Harvard and Yale and all these Ivy League schools. You're kidding yourself, girl. You know, my kids said, "We're tired of school. We're tired of school. I don't necessarily want to go." They all went for a little bitty while. And after a while, I don't want to go to school. Didn't care for it. Good students made good grades, just didn't want to go to school no more. They still excel and do very well in spite of that. But that was my dream because I didn't have the advantage of a college education. So I'm going to be sure that all my kids get it. It never happened. What I desired for them wasn't necessarily their dream. Wasn't necessarily what they were looking for. And parents can get down in the dumps and be depressed and upset because he didn't, you know, this was what I wanted for him. He didn't want it for himself. And that's what you got to deal with. So I'm not going to get uptight about it. I'm going to live my life. I'm going to be happy in spite of it and love my kids in spite of it. Don't get mad with them and stay mad with them. Love them anyway. Because, you know, they could not be healthy. They could have all kinds of issues. There could be a number of things that could make you even more unhappy. So when I look at that, I'm looking at people every day that go through their life and they are so unhappy with the changes that are constantly occurring in their lives that's going to occur anyway. This is the way life goes. I'm given one part. You're given something else. We're all given something. We're all given something we don't necessarily like. And we're all given stuff that we don't necessarily want to go through. But if you go through it, you become a better person rather than less. And so hard times causes us to grow. Hard time causes us to endure all kind of controversy and things that may come our way. We need to go through some rough times. Rough times make good people. It makes strong people. It makes people that don't crumble at the least little thing that go wrong. But I can get through this. And then I can tell somebody else, you can get through it too. And you can. Unhappy individuals oftentimes feel preoccupied with death or doing something to hurt themselves. I never understood that one. Or in some way to try and mask what's happening to them. You seen people look like they were happy? What? Robin Williams was one of those people. He was always laughing and acting a fool all the time. And he'd get on, he's crossing his eyes and carrying a, and sit in a room and killed himself. The mask was, I'm happy. The mask was, I got this good life. And everybody looked at him. He makes people laugh, but he couldn't make himself laugh. He couldn't laugh at what was going on. You know, the greatest thing that can happen to you, I have found through experience, is be able to laugh at difficult things. And when things are really, really bad, if I can learn to look at it and get something about it to laugh about, I'll feel better. Laughter make it work as good like a medicine. That's what the word says. We got too many people who can't laugh. They look like sourpusses every day. Every time you see them, their face is drawn. They won't smile. They're all going through all this stuff. But you know what? The people that can laugh at themselves, they're much happier. So I've got some things wrong. So I don't measure up quite the way I want to. So what? I'm lacking some things. What are you going to do about it? Laugh about it. You know, some people you can't insult anyway. They think they're all of that. No matter what happens. I had four boys and three girls. Four girls and three boys. Okay. All of them are different. All of them. You got one that just, you know, life is good. Hey, flow with it. You'll get another one that just little things seem to antagonize them. You get another one who believes ain't nobody better than them. I mean, I'm on the top of the world. Everybody else got all these issues. Look at me. You got so many things going with these kids. But you know what? I learned to accept each one for who they were and realize just because I had all of them didn't mean they all were going to be the same. And it didn't also automatically mean that they was going to take on my traits and Charles's as well. Because these kids come with some stuff I didn't have, Charles didn't have. I thought, did they give me the wrong kid at the hospital and I didn't know it? Because they're so different in every way. We will enjoy life much better if we just look at the world as one huge place that God has put man here for. But that's why he sent his son. I send Jesus that you might have abundant life so that you can really live. You'd be surprised at the people on the earth that have never learned how to live yet. Just living life with a flow and excited and happy about it. They're not all down in the dump. Every time you see them, they're the same. Some people, if that much goes wrong, you know it. Good morning. What's good about it? Well, for one reason, I can walk and talk. I'm sad that I had to run into you. What's good about it? Go ahead and say, I'm going to make the best of my life and do what I can with what I've got. You know another thing makes people unhappy? We want what you got. Why? The Bible said, thou shalt not covet, meaning you shouldn't want what somebody else got. Be thankful for what you have. It may not be like what they have, and you may not even enjoy it if you had it. Just enjoy your life no matter what. And I'm not going to look next door at the neighbor and say, well, look at there. They got a new car. I'm going to get one. Can you afford it? And maybe he got a raise. Maybe they got an income bracket that you don't fit into. Don't try to go out and get something that other people got just because they got it. People are miserable when you feel only complete when you're accomplishing or making things happen the way it's happening to everybody else. You're miserable. I don't know why God ain't doing this for me. I'm a good person. Maybe you're not quite as good as you thought. Of course, you're not going to admit that. But look at it and say, wait a minute. I could be happy with what I have. The scripture says, I think it's in Hebrews where Paul spoke about it, I think it is, where he was talking about we should be content with such things as we have and not go through a whole bunch of changes. You know what I found out? My grandmother taught me this years ago. And she taught me, she said, whatever's for you in life, you will get it. You don't have to rush. You don't have to push here or there. If it's for you to have it, you will have it. I live by that principle. I never coveted other people's things because to me, those are the things that make you happy. I could have those things that not make me happy. See? For all of us, we're so different. We need to be able to be ourselves. You know how many unhappy women there is because they would look like, I wish I looked like her. I wish I had her legs. I wish I had her hair. Oh, my God, if I had eyes like that. By the time you get through picking up all these things from all these people, you look like a stone nut. Why would I want your blue eyes are beautiful to me on white people. We look real funny with blue eyes. If you go somewhere and get a contact lens and make them in different colors and put it in and you're black, what's wrong with our eyes? For the most part, our eyes are brown. There may be a few black people have it a little bit different, but for the most part, they go with our skin. They're not glaring out like a cat. You know, hey, let's enjoy this. And you know what we've never done? We've never been able to look at other people and enjoy what they have. And say, wow, that's so beautiful on you. I mean, I have seen so many people with hazel eyes, blue eyes, green eyes. Think, wow, that's beautiful. Look at those eyes. I don't want them. I can see out of these eyes. Why I want them? That's good for you, and you can be admired and not go into a tailspin wondering, you know, I wish I could get those. I never went out and bought any colored contacts. First of all, I can't get nothing in my eye without, if I'm trying to get something in there, it's not going to work because tears are going to pour everywhere. So, no, I didn't do it. But a lot of people, other people of other nationalities have done that. They got them different colors. So I'm going to put those in for me. The only thing I don't like about contact lens, people have to be very careful. If you get too dry, they may slip and you can't, eyes start hurting and all this stuff. It's just so nice to have your own. It's just so nice. Life is not difficult if we learn to just enjoy what we have today. Let your conversation be without covetousness. And be content with such things as you have, for he has said, I will never leave you, and I'll never forsake you. I'll always be here for you. Be content with what you have now. You know, as life goes on, sometimes things we couldn't get now, as we continue to grow and go different places in our life, we start getting other things, things changing. That's good. But until you get there, be content. And if I never get there, be content. Because godliness with contentment is great gain. You couldn't have more than to be content. Discontentment makes the world unhappy. Because we wanted to be somewhat different, and things shouldn't have to be this way or that way. Come on. I'm just thankful for what I have. To be content is to be completely satisfied with what one is or has, and not wanting more or anything else. That's what content is. It's okay, I'm fine just like this. You don't want it? No, I'm fine just like this. Thank you. Discontent is a simple thing. I'm just not satisfied. And that's going to automatically make you unhappy. I'm just not happy. What's wrong? Is there so many things I want, so many things I wish I had? Thank God for what you have. Thank God for it. All these things are not going to change you as a person. You are who you are before you get nothing. You are who you are if you have a lot. They said people got rich and they got arrogant. They was arrogant already. See, you didn't have to get rich to get that way. But look at your life today and what God can do in your life. See, so we want so many things. We were kids and we came up in a very, very poor family. And we looked through catalog after catalog and everything in that catalog, that was mine. That's mine. You ain't gonna never get it. And we'll turn pages. Look at this. That's mine's right here. And cousins, our cousins, all of us playing together, we get mad at each other. I said that was mine. It's in the book. And we're uptight about it because, hey, come on. You know, I just said that's mine. And then we used to sit on the curb right in front of our house as cars passed by. I said, next car to come by is my car. Okay? So your cousin's fine. She said, well, the next one's mine, but it's a broke down truck. And she said, I'm not taking it. I'm telling you, we would get all upset, start crying, acting stupid. None of those cars just passed you are yours. But we said, she's trying to claim my car. You know, this is my car. I said the next one was mine. And because the other one's raggedy, she don't want to take it. You're going to have to take it. You know, we go in the house and say, Grandma, she won't let me have my car. We dreamed and dreamed. And I think dreaming is great. But every dream you have, you may or may not have it. See? But we claim things as they pass by. It's mine. I mean, for our uncle to come over with an old car that he bought new, and now in these days a Chevrolet, many days with a fat car, and they come over and take us for a ride. Wow. Oh. And then we argued who was going to get by the window. I'm sitting by the window. No, move in. I'm getting by the window. Up tight. You got grown-ups the same way today. It may not be by the window, but they're upset about something. And you said, this is something I claim. How did you get it before me? You work on a job. I've been looking for this promotion. Why didn't I get it? Wait your time. If you're to have it, you will get it. And don't worry about the person who done wrong to get it. Just don't you do wrong to get it. See, I'm going to make the best of it. We want so much. You gotta say, I'm about to turn my want off because it won't stop. The want is, I have this wish, craving. I am constantly desiring something that makes you tired. I just want to get everything I can get. You know, we don't know how long we're going to live. No, we don't. That's why I enjoy today. Enjoy today. So, we have this deep longing inside. That doesn't make you feel good. It pulls you down because you're longing for something that you possibly may not get. And if you don't, I like to hear people say this, if I get it, it's fine. If I don't, I'm okay. When my husband passed away some years ago, we lived in a house over there near Watson High School. I liked that house. It was only about $160,000, maybe. I said, I'm never leaving this house. I moved in. I changed everything that the owner had in there that I didn't like. I just made a lot of changes. Well, the owner came to the house. He said, Rose, did you like anything I had in here? I said, well, you should be troubled. It's Miles now. So he said, I don't think you like nothing. What was it about my house? He got real irritated. What was it about that you that you liked it? And I said, it's a few things. It's an old neighborhood. Oh, homesteaders there, and know a lot of kids running around. You don't like kids? Yes, I do, but I had seven. And so I could take care of the neighborhood with seven. And so I thought, no, it's not bad. The Lord blessed us to get it. When Charles passed away, I said, I'm never leaving this house, never. This is where all the last 13, 14 years' memories are. I want to stay here. I'm going to die here. My kids kept pushing, saying, Mama, you need to move, you need to move. I'm not moving. I'm staying here. So my daughter came in one day. She said, Mama, would you just go and go with me and look at some houses? I said, I can tell you before I go, yeah, I will look at them, but I'm not moving. My house wasn't what you, it was pretty. I fixed it up just like me. I liked that house. We went around looking for houses and looking for houses. And she said, Mom, what about that? I said, I told you I'm not buying a house. I like this house. But you know what? After a while, I had to start listening to them because homesteaders were either dying or they were moving out, and other people were moving in who didn't take care of the property. And the house next door to me finally moved. They moved down and put the house on the market, and there it was. Nobody cut the grass, and it's standing high enough to come to your waist, and it's junky, it's everything. And I was still trying to find a way to stay there. My daughter said, Mama, you're going to have to move. Yeah, I know. I don't want to move. So I said, why don't we buy the house next door? Then we can clear all that up. No. Man, I said, I don't want to sell it. Mama, you need to move. I know I need to move. I know. Now I'm listening. I need to move. You got this one over here ain't fixed up. That one over there ain't fixed. Across the street, people just letting things go. You need to move. I finally did. You know what I did? I stayed there for 22 years. And I went out looking for a house for $160,000. Are you sick? I said, how much does it cost? It never dawned on me in 20 years. Houses are not $160,000, not the kind of house you're looking for. I said, every time I see one, I said, how much does it cost? The prices I thought were outrageous. But I've been in that house for 22 years. I'm happy here. I mean, hey, this is what's happening. Couldn't find no house to meet the price. And I finally had to get the price out of my head and find a house because I would have never found one. But listen, I wasn't feeling like I had to have one. I really was happy right there until everything around me began to fall apart. When it starts falling apart, common sense says, what you going to do? Are you going to stay in here with all this rundown stuff and all type of people moving into the neighborhood? And it's just, it ain't going to work for you. I'm glad after a while I listened to my kids and I did get a house. And they still say today, the only thing I don't like about the house, I don't like climbing stairs. I look up them steps just like that. Whoa, you got to get up there. So my daughter said, Mama, you need a house where everything for you is on the first floor and you don't need any stairs. I like staircases. I think they make home. They're beautiful. And I said, well, I can have a staircase and let all y'all, when you come over, go up there. Just put everything for me on the first floor. I don't want to have to leave that floor. See, but I'm not in a hurry to move anywhere. I am content. Every time my coach says, Lord, okay, here I go up. In the name of Jesus, let me go up these steps. But you know what? When you are living your life wanting, you can't be happy. You'll never be content with what you got because I'm always wanting something different. What else can I get? What else can I do? Be content with such things as you have. And if the time comes for you to move and have something different, that time will come. If it doesn't, don't worry about it. People don't want to do that. I need to worry. See, I can't treat my neighbor right because my neighbor has everything that I wish I had. You know the story about Lot and Abraham. Abraham, God told him to leave his home. He would make him rich. He made him rich. Lot was his nephew who went with him. And Lot was greedy for things. So when they got to a certain place, when they had gained so much wealth and so many amount of head of herds that they have, and Abraham said, and then their servants started bickering with each other. And Abraham said, "I tell you what, Lot, why don't you pick what you want?" Now he's the one who's inheriting this from God. And he said, "But you pick what you want. If you go left, we'll go right. Let there be no confusion between my herdmen and your herdmen." Because they wanted that. Lot was a man who only wanted things pertaining to this world. You got to want things that's not in this world. That's life eternal. And Lot reached and said, "I'll take that." That was the well-watered part of the land. It was beautiful. It was, he picked the best. But you think if it's mine by inheritance, would you say to me, "No, you pick what you want, Rose, and then I'll take what I want"? Oh, no, he was so greedy. And Abraham let him have it. And God said to Abraham, look at here. Look and see what you will get. I'm going to give you all that you can see over here. I'm going to give it all to you, which was far more than what Lot got. But he was so greedy. He wanted that piece of land. He wanted to be stationed there. That's what he wanted. It was rich. It was had everything that a person would want. That's where we mess up. We say, "I want that because it's the best. There ain't nothing else like it. This works." And then the person over here says, "Well, I'll just be content to stay right here. If you want that, I'll take this." Hardly ever do you find that among people to say, "I prefer you over myself." But that's what the scripture says. Let us prefer our brother before we prefer ourselves. But that doesn't happen often. Because people say, "No, I'm not preferring anybody. Anybody going to get it, I'm going to get it." Shouldn't feel that way. Shouldn't feel like that. Should have an openness to say, "Why don't you have it?" No. Most people are so selfish and so stingy, they live for themselves and nobody else. And that's why they're unhappy. You know what I find out happiness is? Happiness is making somebody else happy. Happiness is when you reach out to a person less fortunate than yourself and you say, "I want to do this for you, not because I get something in return, but because I saw the smile on your face." That's happiness to me. I don't know what you call happiness because everybody got a different definition for it. But the one that makes me happy is that God let me come to a place in my life to have enough that I can say to somebody else, "Let me help you. Let me do this for you." That's where joy is. That's where excitement is. There's nothing that makes me happier in the whole world than when somebody gets something they didn't know they was going to get or couldn't afford to get it, and you get it for them and see their face light up. That's happiness. Nothing is better than that. We had a lady come by our house 2 Christmases ago. We decorate a lot to put the Christmas message out. It's all about Christ. It's not about Santa. It's not about the bells. It's about him. So everything is a religious thing on our yard. And this lady that came up to my house, I didn't know she was out there. And she came and she looked at the lights and she said, "I wonder how much did all these lights cost?" And then she said, "And I have 2 children and I can't even get them 1 gift for Christmas." Well, she wrote a note, and she left it on the windshield of my daughter's car that was parked in the driveway at the time. And she said, "I've got 2 children, and I can't even buy a Christmas gift for not even one gift." I remember that. And so I said to my daughter, "Is there a phone number on the note?" She said, "Yes." I said, "Give it to me." So I called this lady. And I said, "You were at my house looking at the lights the other night?" She said, "Yes." She hesitated, like, "What was I calling her for?" And I said, "The reason why we put up so many lights, it gets the message out." I said, "If you put up 1 light on the porch, nobody comes. But if you light it up enough, people will come and listen and read the message. I said, but what are you? I said, I'll buy your kids Christmas things. She said, you said what? I said, I'll buy it. I said, how old are your kids? She told me how old they were. And I said, I'll get it for you. So I sent my daughter and somebody else out to buy the Christmas gifts for her kids and bought the Christmas tree and all the decorations to go on it. And they went over to where she lived and they decorated it. At first, she was in a hotel. Her lights, her utilities had been cut off. And so they were living in a hotel that they couldn't afford hardly from day to day. And so I said, do you want to go home? She said, yeah, but it's too cold for my kids. I said, how much is your electric bill? She said, I'm not quite sure. I said, I'll have my daughter call down there and put it on a charge card and pay for it. She said, you would do that? Yes. Because how are you going to have Christmas? So my daughter called down there, and the bill was $900 and some dollars. And we paid it. And I said, you can go home now. And they will be there with the Christmas stuff for you. And she went home, and her two little kids were just screaming and hollering, Mama, Mama, look at what Santa gave to us. Now, if you won't think of me as Santa, go ahead. But they were so excited. Those kids were so happy, and they were running around with the decoration, helping to put them on the tree and jumping up and down. And I said, I bet you she don't have no food. So I told my daughter, I said, we got to buy her some food. So we sent her $300 for food. And I said, give her an extra $200 in case she needs something else. That was Christmas. See, if it's only what you can do for you, that ain't happiness. I thought about that so many times. She came to the church twice. I haven't seen her since. But that was okay. Life is about giving of you, of yourself. But if only person you want to have something is you, you're never going to be really happy. But the more you give, I remember the times I didn't have it. And nobody came to my aid. I don't want to be one of those people that don't come to somebody's aid. But reach out and say, let me help you. Every first Sunday of the month, we honor our military because they sacrifice much for our lives. My husband was a military man. I understand where they are. Every first Sunday, we give them a gift card, and it has $50 bill, and it has $20 gas, and it has where they can go and have dinner for two, and we give that to the soldier. But the big thing is while they're all standing up here, and sometimes we've had as high as 48 soldiers here, and we said, now this is the bonus. It's $1,000. They don't know what it is when you say, well, I want to give you something. So people looking like this. Says 100, 200, 300. And they say 400, 500, 600. And just keep, and you get to the 1,000. And this one guy, I shall never forget him. Where is he? Yeah, that one too, but I'm talking about another one. That one was exciting too, but this boy, he was about to faint. He kept saying. He kept doing this. And he was so excited, and his hands started trembling and shaking, and him and his brother was here, two white guys that were sitting back over here. And so his hands started shaking real bad, and he said, and Brenda said, honey, you're not going to faint. He said, I mean, he was in the game. Honey, we were having a ball that Sunday, because some people get excited more than others. And this boy, he takes the cake. And then he said, him and his brother was going somewhere. They didn't have a place to stay. Okay, I told my daughter, call the hotel. Let's put them up for 2 weeks, and then they could be on their feet and whatever, because they had a job. They're getting ready to start. Happy? I went home. I felt like every time those soldiers come in here, when they say it's Soldier Sunday, I could just die. That's where happiness is. So you know why you're so unhappy? Because all you want is what you can get. You know, I need some shoes. I need a new coat. What about the other people that don't have one? Sometimes you got two or three. Ain't gonna give away none. No, Granny gave that to me. No, I got that from my uncle. Are you gonna give anything? Giving. That's why God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Whosoever should believe in him shall not perish but have eternal life. So happiness. I must not close this message without saying it is contingent upon what you do to make somebody else happy. And if you're not willing to do that, you're a bunch of talk. You shouldn't be happy. You got all this stuff. I listened to Joyce Meyer on TV one day, and they're multimillionaires, and she said the Lord told her to give this lady a pair of earrings. A pair of earrings. And she said, I looked at my drawer, and I looked at all my earrings. I picked this one. I said, Lord, I like that one. And I picked this up and said, Lord, I like that. And she said, I picked it up. I said, I like that, too. She said, Lord, you're going to have to help me because I'm telling you right now, I like all my earrings. I thought, earring? You know, you can buy an earring anytime. She struggled with an earring. I'm trying to understand. Give her 10 of them. If he say give one, give 10. No, we don't do that. We just want to keep our lives. My plans are is that we're going to, 5 years from now, we should be here. Another 5 years, we should be there. And we're going to live a good life. Then we're going to lay up goods. And we're going to retire. And we're going to have this big life. Like the rich man said, I got too much stuff. He said, I'm going to build new barns, bigger barns, so I can put all this stuff in there. Why are you going to build bigger barns? Give what you got that won't fit to other people. That's what a lot of people do. They just hog it for themselves. Hog it for themselves. And how much more can I get? No. I make it a point all during the year that you're going to reach out to where people are and send my daughters and my some of the members out in the community finding out where people's pain is. Let's relieve that pain. All of us, nobody likes pain. What are you doing to relieve it? When I care, I find a way to relieve that. That's happiness. And watch those mothers cry in the aisles, in the stores, when they're trying to buy their kids school supplies and don't have the money to buy it. I send my kids, and sometimes the ladies on the church get with them, and they go in the aisles, and they listen. And she says, I can't buy that. So it's good to be nosy then. And listening to these people and saying, okay, what can, here, we heard what you said. Here's the money for it. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Oh, can you believe this? And they call me on the phone and say, Mama, these people are crying, hugging our necks, telling us thank you. And I'm sitting at home like a contented cow. Boy, just as happy as all get out. This is what we live for. Live for somebody else, not for you. And then somebody will live for you. It's just something good just continually goes round and round. You do good today, somebody does good over here. You do good today, somebody do good over here. They say, this is good. The happiness you will derive from helping somebody else to be happy, there is nothing in the whole world that can replace it. Gotta do this. Gotta do it. If you think about somebody else instead of you, whoa, life is awesome. And be willing to share. If you got a little bit, be willing to share a little bit. If you got a lot, be willing to share a lot. Reach out. Reach out. And say, you made the difference. When I leave this world, for sure, I would truly have made a difference in other people's lives that could not help themselves. And we all need to come to that point. That it's about loving you, not you loving me. Because my love comes from the fact that you love me, not me, not in love me. You love me. Thank you. Don't ever, ever live your life only for you, because there's no real joy and fulfillment in it. You can get all these cars and all these homes and all the clothes that you can get, but unless you're willing to reach out and help that person who don't have a dress or a pair of shoes or any food on the table, every time you eat, you should look up and thank God for it and think about somebody else who don't have it. I was in prayer this morning prior to coming to the service. Lord, remember the homeless people this morning. Yeah. That are on the streets, sleeping under bridges. Help us, God. Help them to know that somebody loves you. Somebody cares about you. Important. Important. I never pass a person on the street with a sign say, I'll work for to get money to pay my rent, or I'm gonna pull over, I got to. One man stood on that corner, yeah, I felt so sorry. He said, well, you don't know if they for real or not. I don't care about that part. I care about helping somebody. He at least looks like he needs help. What are you gonna do? Make up your mind, if I see somebody like that, stop for a minute. Only way I don't stop is that I'm in the wrong lane and I can't get out of it. And one time we got out, went all the way up and came all the way back around, but he was gone. Just to say somebody cares. Where are you at this morning in happiness? Unhappiness calls people to have physical problems. It would tell you that people that have a heart attack will live longer if they're happy people. They're more likely to survive surgery if they're happy. Happiness has everything to do with what kind of life you have. Keep reaching out. Keep giving. There's not a Christmas. There's not Easter where we're not doing something to help. What can we do? And watch these people come and go out that door and say, wow. That young man who stood up that was honored for the soldiers last week, he gave me a hug and he said in my ear, you'll never know how bad I needed this money. From a time his number was called, he said, thank God. He didn't even know what he was going to get. See? But when he got up there, is this for real? Yes. Somebody's giving somebody something in the church instead of taking it? Yes. It's a fact. Let's reach out. And some people say, well, I'm only going to reach out if they do this for me and don't just go off and forget me. I'm not worried about whether you ever remember me. I want to remember that I did good when I could. That's what makes the difference. So look at your life this morning and say, I'm unhappy. But I don't live for nobody but me. One man prayed a prayer. He said, Lord, bless me, my wife, our two kids, us four and no more. What kind of prayer is that? All about him. I want to tell you how difficult things are for me. Really? Did you find out how your next door neighbor was doing? Of course, up in my neighborhood, you would dare not do that. Or they'd say, oh, no, thank you. Give it to someone who needs it. They're so arrogant. Just say, oh, honey, I don't need it, but I hope you find somebody who can. It's so arrogant. Yeah. You don't even want to hardly go up that part of town and try to help, pass out things helping people. Just uppity. And you could be down tomorrow. Just because you're up today doesn't guarantee you tomorrow. Stop and listen. I hope you'll take this message this week and say, you know what? I never thought about that. I'm so busy being sure everything is all right for me. That's all that matters to me. And then you die and leave it. Solomon said you die and leave it. You don't know if a wise man or a fool gonna get it. He said, I got a problem with who's got my wealth after I'm gone. Maybe get an old drunk cousin or somebody that ain't never hit a lick at a snake and they can get everything you got. He said, this is all vanity and vexation of spirit. You walk around here, save, save, save. I believe you should save some, and I believe you should live with some. No, we ain't going to live. And if need be, you can go back in there in the savings. something. So, oh, no, you don't touch that. Touch it for somebody else. And I'll guarantee you, you won't lose nothing. You won't lose nothing. Happiness is knowing Jesus, having him in your life, saying, you know, I'm not a Christian, but I find myself up and down all the time. You accept him in your heart, you won't be that way. He makes you happy. When difficult times are in your life, when the death of my husband after 35 years suddenly comes to an end, my daughter, 29 years old, 4 years later, where are you at? I'm happy because I have him. Not happy that I lost my husband. Not happy that my daughter passed away. But it's a part of life. We can't change it. The word of God tells us we all gonna die one day. All of us. We gotta make the best of it while we got it. And in the meantime, make up in your mind, I'm going to be different. Think about the other person. Think about somebody else's pain, somebody else's loss, somebody else's feeling of being unloved in this world. You know how many people, they commit suicide for one fact is that they don't feel like nobody loves them. You don't have to know a person to give them a hug. I love to hug people. I don't meet anybody where I don't get a hug. The chiropractor who's been coming to the house, and his name is Blake. And he said to me the other day, he said, Rose, he said, boy, I'm so glad I met y'all. Little tiny guy, he ain't much taller than that. He said, y'all, it's so warm and friendly. And he stood there, and my daughter said, and Blake, we're glad we met you. He said, just feels good to come here. All your family is smiling and everybody's happy. Yeah, not because we don't have some trouble. Not because we don't have some things that's not so good in our lives. The thing that she announced this morning about the guys that invented this software, one's my son, one's my son-in-law. Son-in-law went to the Air Force Academy. My son was a air traffic controller in the Navy. These are all great guys. You come to steal their software, and when you didn't get it, you put them in jail. I could be up here this morning like, I hate everybody. No. No other software ever like it. Still not to this day. And we still have it. And they thought they was going to get the code so they could do it, put a new name on it. That's what the FBI director said to Congress. They never got it. And we've been fighting every day for our men's lives. And you know what? Now we got Congress involved with it. Somebody asked me, Rose, do you think this is about race or about money? I said, I think both of them play a part, money and race. But Judge Sarikin, the appellate judge, says, I don't know what happened. He said, I'll tell you what. I will look at this case. If I find that you lied to me about one thing, I'll drop it and never touch it again. He never found a lie. To this day, he is still pushing forward on this case. He says the worst miscarriage of justice he ever seen in the history of the time that he was appellate judge. Never, he says, have I ever asked any president to pardon any person. But in this case, he wrote a letter to the White House. If any men need to be pardoned, you need to do it for these. No crime committed nowhere. All because you wanted what they had. And you could have had it, just pay for it. You don't want to pay for it. You want to steal it. But we fought, and we still fight. We're almost over now. Praise God. Praise God. And you know what? I could come here this morning and say, I don't know if I'll be able to talk to you now because bad stuff in our life. We're going to win. We all won. We won. Put my daughter in prison because the men wouldn't take a plea deal for 6 months with evidence laying in front of the judge's face that no, she's not guilty of anything. And say, I don't care. The lawyer said, it don't matter whether she brings evidence of being innocent. She's going to get some jail time because if they don't take a plea deal, we're going to put your daughter in jail. I like to die. But I revived. I never stopped preaching this gospel. I never stopped working with people. You can't let your situation turn you away. You get so engrossed with your own pain, your own trouble, until you can't think about nobody else. Can't do it. I hope this morning that everybody here will take this message and say, I found out why I'm unhappy. First of all, you don't have the Lord in your heart, because that's the key to it. And then secondly, I reached out because of the love of God in my heart to somebody else. You can have it. God bless you. Well, our musicians and singers, please come forward. And if you're sitting there this morning saying, Sister Rose, I'm an unhappy person, start searching inside yourself. See why you're unhappy. Many things can make you unhappy. Many things. Unhappiness causes people to be ill and have all type of sickness and what have you. You don't have to be there. You don't have to be there. Think about it. So while they begin to sing and to play, if you would please stand. And those of you that want prayer, if you come this morning, we'll pray for you.